Remember this cool space plane here that our favorite company on Earth, Boeing, was supposed to build? It appears to be too much for them. The engineering challenge just seems to be too brutal for poor Boeing. Then SpaceX has a new satellite launch contract, already so earlier in the year. And of course Starship. We must talk about the upcoming ramp-up of the Starship production. Because make no mistake, what we see here is the first part of a future Starship Gigafactory, where Starships will be mass-produced in order to build Elon's 1,000 Starship fleet. But how can SpaceX achieve this?
And after shooting the video, we got the really, really bad news of a new bill which was being discussed in the House of Representatives. And if this bill would pass, it would basically kill the Artemis program. So let's take a closer look at what this bill proposes, because it would introduce some significant changes for the future NASA crewed spaceflight program. And as you can imagine, the changes are not of a positive nature.
On the topic of SpaceX and Mars colonization, we must talk about all these renderings showing how future Mars spaces would look like. Hint, they won't look anything like depicted in the renderings. But why not? And how would they actually look? Let's find out! Boeing, oh man, this is brutal. After your 737 MAX disaster, and after your epic failure to reach the ISS with Starliner, you now drop the DARPA-funded XS-1 spaceplane that you've been developing for over 2.5 years now. Like seriously, Boeing, how can you fail on so many different levels? Now, back in May 2017, Boeing was awarded $146 million to design and build an aircraft-like launch system to launch both military and commercial payloads. Northrop Grumman and Maston Space Systems were beaten by Boeing, so that Boeing was selected as the only company to further pursue the program and to start building a prototype for testing this year. Now, the XS-1 would have measured 30 meters in length with a 19-meter wingspan. It would have flown suborbital trajectories at speeds faster than Mach 10 and would have been capable of depositing small satellites weighing up to around 2 metric tons into orbit. But now they are out! It seems to have been too much of a challenge for Boeing.
Oh damn, this looks more difficult than we thought. What should we do?
How about we take the $146 million for the contract and then just quietly drop out? How about that?
That's an awesome idea! So where's the outrage? Where's the freaking outrage from our beloved mainstream news media? Huh? They are so quick to bash SpaceX every time for even the slightest failure, but here? Oh, no outrage. What's going on?
Hey Boeing, we have an advice for you. Leave the development of new challenging space hardware to the big boys over at SpaceX. You know, they are developing a launch system which is much more capable, and they do it much faster, and they will certainly not drop out of the development of Starship, contrary to you. You know what? Let's do a prediction, because we always like doing predictions, as you know.
We honestly think that Boeing will go bankrupt within the next 10 years. If SpaceX doesn't kill them, then Tesla's VTOL supersonic electric jets certainly will. But make no mistake, Boeing is already on an irreversible path towards doom.
So after shooting the video here, and while already starting to edit, we by chance found out about a highly disturbing new bill, and we have to talk about it. Therefore, please forgive us that we are recording this now via microphone. Probably in order to keep the wonderful company Boeing alive longer with good old taxpayer money, this new bill is being discussed in the House of Representatives, which in our opinion has only one goal: to further drag on the SLS development time so that Boeing will get more billions of dollars in order to develop a rocket which will never fly, and to secure the giant job creation program which is the SLS. So let us take a close look at this wonderful bill, which by the way has 102 pages. The key elements we could read out are as follows. First, the Artemis program would be basically cancelled and renamed Moon to Mars program, with the goal of landing on the Moon in 2028 and the goal of sending a crewed mission to orbit Mars by 2033. Second, the Lunar Gateway would be now renamed Gateway to Mars. We have to hold ourselves back not to burst out in laughter, by the way, while reading this. Third, the SLS Block 2 configuration shall already start development because, hey, let's give more money to Boeing.
Four, a lunar outpost is not envisioned anymore in the Moon to Mars program. Crewed landings on the Moon that do not contribute to the goal of landing humans on Mars shall also not be included anymore in this program. And now the funniest part. Which idiot wrote this crap? Holy mother of God. Okay, here we go. Lunar in situ resource utilization shall not be considered as risk reduction for the initial crewed missions to orbit and land on Mars. Any lunar in situ resource utilization activities shall not be included in the Moon to Mars program and shall be budgeted separately from the Moon to Mars program. Yeah, so understanding how to live and work on the Moon doesn't reduce the risks for a crewed Mars landing in any way. LOL. Just LOL. So friends, this is really, really bad. If this bill gets passed, not only will Artemis get effectively cancelled and a Moon landing postponed to 2028, no, the ISS would also be kept in service until 2028, by the way. And the SLS development time would of course be further dragged out without of course ever flying a single mission. The Gateway being renamed Gateway to Mars is the most ridiculous ever. Together with the fact that lunar in situ resource utilization is not considered meaningful for a Mars mission. So this basically means that a moon base or a moon colony is effectively cancelled. That, people, is what we get when politicians try to be smart. They have no freaking clue about spaceflight. Lunar in situ resource utilization is probably the most important thing. Learning to live on the Moon and utilize the Moon's resources is extremely important in order to understand how to work and live on another world. This will be extremely important for Mars. So yeah, we are brutally disappointed and really hope that this bill won't get passed. It will be reviewed on the 29th of January, by the way. If it will get passed, it's a nice reminder that we should put our trust only in Elon and SpaceX, and that NASA is just a political puppet, nothing more. And we will not ever get anything done anymore. Not ever. For SpaceX, on the other hand, things are just looking perfect. Not only was last week's in-flight abort test of Crew Dragon picture perfect, paving the way for crewed flights to the ISS in quarter 2 this year. Nay, SpaceX already has a new launch contract for Falcon 9, so early in the year. They are to launch the Nilesat 301 satellite for Egypt in 2022. Well, look here! A country that isn't corrupted by Boeing and Lockheed lobbying naturally choose SpaceX to launch their satellite into orbit. Who would have thought? Maybe that has something to do with the fact that a launch on a Falcon 9 rocket costs far less than a launch on a ULA rocket. US Congress can try to keep inefficient companies like Boeing or Lockheed alive with taxpayer money all they want. The world will, however, not be stupid enough to charter ULA rockets to launch their payloads into orbit. No, they will choose the best option, which is SpaceX. And SpaceX is as always very busy, further developing the Starship factory. We will just call it a Starship factory, because this tent here at Boca Chica is the first part of a gigantic Starship assembly line. We could even go as far as to call the Boca Chica Starship Factory the very first piece of a future Starship Gigafactory. In order to achieve the 1,000 Starship vision, which Elon tweeted about a week ago, parts need to be mass-produced, costs therefore driven down. Processes need to be automated and standardized. They will basically have to be like Tesla, but for much larger parts. What we see in this shot here is a tank dome for a second tank prototype, which will again undergo burst tests. At some point, we will see more and more of these tents, churning out different parts for future starships. Some tents will produce only domes, some only steel rings, some other only super heavy parts. And in order to increase efficiency, Raptor engine production should also be done on site at some point in the future. We will see a Starship Gigafactory emerge at Boca Chica, and here are just the first steps. And this is highly needed, or else Starship will never be produced in numbers which we will need to become multiplanetary. The giant Starlink revenue will certainly help with that endeavor, but also the fact that things are looking perfect for Tesla, which will certainly have a positive impact as well, because Elon will have more capital to boost Starship production. Therefore, we think what we see here is indeed the very first step towards a Starship Gigafactory, enabling an interplanetary future for humanity.
And how this interplanetary future might look like, we are shown time and time again in some very beautiful SpaceX renderings. I mean, the renderings are really wonderful to look at and very inspiring, but there's only one slight problem. They are brutally wrong from a scientific point of view. And that comes from us, like total die-hard SpaceX fans. So then why are these renderings wrong, you might ask? Why will a future base on Mars not look like anything we are shown in these renderings? Well, this is very simple, because of the two very big enemies of future human Mars settlement. First, cosmic rays, and second, low gravity. Now, many newer studies show that cosmic ray bombardment would have really extremely negative long-term effects on brain function, with the effect of severely reduced mental capacity, even leading to cognitive diseases. Now, this is because of the deadly shower of secondary particles created when high-energy cosmic particles with energies of up to 10 to the 18 electron volts hit the hull of a ship or a habitat, and this in turn creates an intense shower of secondary neutrons, which hit our brains and our tissue and our DNA with such extreme force that it leads to extreme damage in the cells and the biological tissue. The other big enemy of humanity in space is zero or low gravity. Now, while we certainly know by now that zero gravity is extremely bad for the human body over longer periods of time, leading to muscle loss and an increased risk of heart disease, among many other problems, many suspect that even low gravity environments are still quite bad, especially for children. Now, while people aged 50 or 55 and more can more easily adapt to such extreme environments, younger people and especially children would suffer some extremely negative health impacts with life-threatening results. Now, a child born on the Moon or Mars would, with a very high probability, not live over the age of 30 in a Mars base as depicted here. Dr. Joseph Parker gave a very good talk on that topic at a Mars Society conference, and we highly recommend you to watch it, link in the description. So then, how should a Mars base really look like? Well, of course, we need to go underground. Not only would we then be instantly protected from all sorts of solar and even cosmic radiation, but no, there are already giant underground caves present on Mars, as we know. Now, building bases there would be very easy, and we could even incorporate tunnels dug with boring machines into the underground base, and thus also solve the low gravity problem in the process. Let us explain. Why live in stationary shelters if we can have rotating train pod habitats that create artificial 1G Earth gravity simply by rotation? This animation by Dr. Joseph Parker shows that a 1 kilometer radius track, for example, with pods going at 360 kilometers per hour would lead to a nice and comfortable 1G artificial gravity effect. Now, spending half of the day on these rotating train home pods would be enough to prevent detrimental long-term health effects. Now with such pods, children could even be born and live on Mars, even on the moon, without the danger of birth defects or the danger of dying at a young age. But then you say, wait, 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 how will these rotating train pods be powered? They certainly will need a lot of power, right? Please don't forget that it's quite cold in those underground tunnels on the moon or Mars. So magnetic coils using high temperature superconductors would not need a lot of energy to be cooled down to superconducting temperatures. Therefore, a combination of solar arrays and radioisotope thermoelectric generators will be enough to provide the necessary energy. Because once you reach superconductivity, the energy requirements are absolutely minimal to retain this state. So then you would have a nice rotating superconducting maglev train on which we would live and work for half the day. And because on the moon we have a perfect vacuum and on Mars almost a perfect vacuum, we have no air resistance. So therefore the energy requirements for those rotating train pod habitats are quite a lot lower than you might actually think.
So yeah, our future Mars bases probably won't look anything like these renders here. But of course, they look inspirational and beautiful. And rotating underground cities certainly don't have the same appeal. By the way, the problems of cosmic rays and zero-g are also the two main dangers for travels to and from Mars in Starship. Some kind of shielding against cosmic rays is needed, be it shielding based on hydrogenated boronitride nanotubes, or be it water shielding. And some form of Starship rotation for the trip will also be needed. Starship without any rotation or shielding will lead to the astronauts arriving on Mars in a very, very bad state. Therefore, we will never stop talking about these issues because they really have to be solved. Elon is a genius, but he cannot think of everything. He already has a lot on his mind, one might say, single-handedly helping to greatly accelerate the transition to a sustainable society based on renewable energy, and also making humanity a multi-planetary species at the same time. Oh yeah, and in the process also prevent an AI humanity destruction event by helping us merge with machine intelligence. So cosmic rays and zero-g are really problems that some other people need to address. But we often like to say, any problem can be solved with good engineering and science, as long as it doesn't contradict the laws of physics, and as long as the contract isn't given to Boeing. So we are absolutely sure that we will see cities on Mars in this century, and on the moon, and even elsewhere in the solar system.
So what do you say to another epic Boeing failure? It seems to become their habit, you know, failing over and over and over again.
And do you agree with us that we are already seeing the first signs of a future Starship Gigafactory at Boca Chica?
So be sure to subscribe and turn on the notification bell, because we keep coming with 2 videos per week on topics of spaceflight, electric cars, and other disruptive technologies.
Promised!
See you next time!